our work, titled Simple Sequence Repeats, SSRRs, indicate evolution hotspots in goldfish, Carassius serratus and cypronida fish. This work actually grows for our private initiative. It has no funding whatsoever, and it is quite recent. And of course, we hope that there are some expert collaborators out there that would like to join us. So, what actually is a simple sequence repeat? There are many types of repeated DNA. Some of them are long, like ALU repeats, line and sign, and so on. And SSRs, or simple sequence repeats, there is also a historical name, such as microsatellites. And this is actually 1 to 6 nucleotides that repeated straight one by one up to dozens of times. While talking about SSRRs, we should also notice that it is including VNTRs that once were used from genetic proximity assessment prior to active development of NGS. What is interesting about these sequences is that they are highly mutagenic. Some of us heard maybe many times about so-called trinucleotide expansions, such as Huntington disease. You know, 13 in HouseMD had it, this disease. In this disease, some portion of DNA grows in length uncontrollably. This is called expansions. It is not just 3 nucleotides, sometimes it is 6 nucleotide expansions, and sometimes it is construction, which means that they are collapsing, their length decreasing dramatically. But the fact is that these kind of sequences are highly unstable and can change their length very fast after they have reached a threshold. The cause of this is deficiency in replication system, and once they reach length of 20 to 30 repeated units, they sometimes can grow uncontrollably, and there's no system of regulation that can slow them down. Besides this medical meaning behind SSRs, it is also interesting in terms of morphological variation and connection between length and purity, which means perfect primary structure of SSR pass, and some morphological trait that undergone strict selection, like in dogs. This is a paper, not that recent paper, in which several, or actually many, dog breeds were studied in terms of how changes in their morphological traits, like clinorhynchia, which means bent nose, in bulldogs, and other traits in other breeds, is connected to the length of this dog's SSR's length that is located inside this gene that encode this very target traits. This is actually a correlation, very pronounced, that shows that length of repeated region correlate positively with the angle of bent nose in bulldogs. The author also noticed that purity of SSRs is also affected. If we have gene that is under strict evolutionary pressure, selection pressure, SSRs that located inside it is very pure, right in their sequences. Why it is interesting and meaningful? I like trinucleotides and so on. Structure can form non-canonical structure of DNA. Structures that differ from B form, B form. This includes imperfect hairpins, G quartets, and so on. This structure is actually connected with instability, impediment of various gene expression processes, and even an interesting process of DNA fragility, in which a part of chromosome can actually fly away because of some portion, especially adjacent to its termini, can break down. Our study subject is Carassius serratus, namely goldfish, domesticated goldfish, and various cyprinidae fish. Why we choose to use these animals? It is studied quite good that these fish have a very dramatic and unusual evolutionary history. Namely, goldfish and its ancestors undergone a whole genome duplication twice. And so it now has two nearly identical genomes that's slightly different and actually mutate and developed quite independently. Besides this, relatives of goldfish is known to be implicated in massive genome rearrangement, interspecies and even interphylum hybridization. And the most important for us is that goldfish undergone a centuries-long strict evolution pressure during selection. Selection for very simple and traceable traits, including form of fins, including coloration, something that can actually be traced very, very easily. Not like dogs, because we need dogs to be patient, to be man-loving. There's no need for fishes in this. And the finishing move is complete genome sequenced just last year that provides us with exhaustive information about primary sequences of this genome. What can actually we see in relatives of goldfish? That it has two nearly identical genomes that developed independently, and so common carp does. What's also interesting that it is quite closely related to zebrafish, being one of the beloved study subjects, and we actually can see that many sequences in goldfish are aligned to zebrafish genomes. Where our data came from? We use fish microsat database, in which multiple SSRs data for invertebrates and fish, from which we choose cyprinidae representatives, namely 28. And more particularly, we choose only the fishes that have over 15 SSR sets. Using literature and data available, we split the species into three groups. Mainly it is free-living species, shown in green, domesticated, bred by human species, and very few decorative species that actually can be fished out from water body, and then it is used as a decorative species. If we looked in on their nucleotide composition, you can see that there are no clear patterns, and so AT dinucleotides are prevalent, and so there is no such clear picture. But if we looked actually on length of SSRs, we can see that very few species have length of SSRs that exceed threshold of stability, which means 20 to 30 nucleotides, depending on whether it is dinucleotide or trinucleotide. And this agrees with our suggestion, our initial suggestion, that domesticated species, not all, but it is mostly domesticated, have very long SSRs, which are not that many. Most of SSRs in this species are short, but these species have some outstanding, very long SSRs. If you looked on their primary sequences by calculating oligonucleotides ratio, this means that we calculated frequency of dinucleotides, trinucleotides, up to four nucleotides, and use PCA, principal component analysis, for three key species, which means very domesticated Carassius auratus, quite domesticated Gibellio carp, and free living Carassius carassius. We can see some clear distinction. This prevalence of TG dinucleotides I showed later also agrees well with the fact that TG repeats known to have way more mutagenic activity. NCA repeats known to have way lower. And so if you looked on two clusters, joint clusters, we also look on oligo compositions for mixed together domesticated fishes and free living fish. We can see that domesticated are clearly more prone to have highest content of GT and related trinucleotides and tetranucleotides. If the same data is analyzed with hierarchical clusterization, we can actually see that some domesticated fish can be separated, left portion of the dendrogram contains the most of them, and free living mostly grouped on the right. And overall, we can say, using our data, that nucleotide composition of SSRs, sets and cypernida, varies significantly and is species specific. Moreover, domesticated species have generally longest SSRs in some case, and they are long enough to be unstable, to undergo contraction and expansions. Primary sequences of SSRs in domesticated versus free living species differs distinctly in terms of TG overrepresentation, which agrees well with TG being more mutagenic. Both hierarchical clusterization and PCA allow to distinguish these two groups. We conclude that this model system, this study subject, is a very good form investigation of SSR in connection evolution and morphological selection. Thank you. Feel free to ask any question.